Section 533 and the public policy underlying it do not apply here because the wrongdoers will not benefit if Continental honors its coverage obligations. The proceeds of the policy will go to the exchangers and not to the wrongdoers. The wrongdoers won't be relieved of their liability as a result of the payments because under the express language of the surety endorsement and equitable principles by operation of law, Continental will be subrogated to the exchangers' claims against the wrongdoers to the full extent of the payment to the exchangers. Thus, the only thing that will change if Continental honors its coverage obligations is that the identity of the claimant against the wrongdoers will change. Instead of the exchangers or Mr. Dillon on their behalf, it will be Continental. Your Honors, there is nothing, no evidence in the record that supports the district court's view. The district court's views about the wrongdoers benefiting are really pure speculation. All of the evidence is to the contrary. The language of the surety endorsement, the views of those who created it, and the marketing materials associated with the policy. Endorsement 3 of the policy states that any losses paid by Continental will be subject to all rights of recovery that we, as surety in this undertaking of employee dishonesty coverage, may have against you, that is Vesta, and your partners. That's the policy of the record at ER 2393. Thus, after it is required to comply with its coverage obligations, its contractual obligations under Endorsement 3, the surety endorsement, Continental, through subrogation, steps into the shoes of Mr. Dillon slash the exchangers and maintains all claims against the wrongdoer that Dillon possesses. Extrinsic evidence is consistent with the plain language of Endorsement 3. The evidence of insurance associated with the policy, the record at ER 755, states that the policy, quote, insures against losses resulting from dishonest acts such as embezzlement, conversion, fraud, theft, etc., of the insurance employees, partners, and owners against the insurance clients. The marketing materials, ER 761, describe the coverage to include, quote, losses your clients, the exchangers, sustain resulting from dishonest acts of your employees, partners, or owners.
So the district court relied on Clever, and that's not a bond case, but how do you treat Clever?
So the Clever case and the other cases that the district court and Continental rely on are really third-party liability cases, and the distinction is that in the context of a third-party liability case where the insured commits a wrongful act and then the insurance company pays the claim, the insurance company is paying the claim to the insured that committed the wrongful act, and the insured is then relieved of liability for the consequences of its wrongful act.
Is Clever the murder case?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you.
And so the reason for that is there is no right of subrogation under a typical third-party liability policy, or indeed a fidelity policy before it had the surety endorsement. There's no right of subrogation by the insurance company. The insurance company can't pay the wrongdoer and then turn around and seek subrogation from the wrongdoer and say, give me the money back. So the wrongdoer in the Clemmer context and in the context of all of those other cases is being paid to reimburse him or her for the liability to the third party and is being relieved of liability. The insurance company takes it on. A surety policy or a surety arrangement is completely different from that.
Before you move on, could I just, isn't that why the district court thought it could rely on Clemmer? Because Vesta was one of the insureds here.
Well,
my understanding of the record was that then you were arguing about whether or not the wrongdoer's conduct could be imputed to Vesta.
Right, but it's, yes, Your Honor, but it's not really a function of whether the wrongdoer's conduct is imputed because Vesta is insured. It's an insured under the policy. So even if Vesta is deemed to have been the wrongdoer, it doesn't change the equation. And Clemmer is inapplicable.
But that was the analysis in the district court, wasn't it?
Well,
wasn't that what the district court, how the district court got to where he got?
Right, but the district court failed to consider or failed to appreciate the fact that in the Clemmer context, the wrongdoer is being relieved of liability. If Vesta is deemed to have been the wrongdoer, Vesta is not being benefited by Continental's payment to the exchangers, because the money goes to Mr. Dillon in this context to be held and paid over to the exchangers. It doesn't go to Vesta. It doesn't go to Mr. Terzakis. It doesn't go to Mr. Estepinian. It doesn't go to Mr. E. They don't get the money. It doesn't become a part of the general assets of Vesta. It goes to the exchangers, and Vesta, if it's imputed to Vesta, remains liable. Mr. Terzakis, Mr. Estepinian remain fully liable. What happened in Clemmer was if the money was paid and the money then went to the injured party, the wrongdoer who committed the murder was then relieved of financial responsibility. Here, the wrongdoers are not relieved of financial responsibility. All that happens is instead of facing Mr. Dillon and the exchangers, they face a multi-billion dollar corporation with endless resources to pursue a subrogated claim for reimbursement of the amounts that got paid to the exchangers against them. So that's really the distinction. Even though the ultimate beneficiary in Clemmer would be the decedent's heirs or survivors, along the way, the wrongdoer is being relieved of liability because the insurance company is paying the liability. And there's no subrogation claim to then go and get it back from the wrongdoing insured. That's really the fundamental distinction. So the district court's ruling granting summary judgment is in error because the district court was wrong, and there's nothing in the record to support the notion that the wrongdoers are being relieved of liability or benefiting in any way by Continental's payment, in contradistinction to the Clemmer case and the other cases that are relied on by the district court and by Continental. And I should say Continental does not cite, nor did the district court cite, one single surety case in which the court denied coverage on the basis of Section 533 because surety arrangements are completely different. The district court's ruling granting summary judgment to Continental was also error because in basing its ruling on its view that, quote, it cannot be said with certainty that any recovery would not go to benefit the perpetrators, close quote, the district court turned the summary judgment standard on its head by failing to view the evidence in the light most favorable to Vesta as a non-moving party. So we've talked a little bit about the fact that under California law, in case after case, which we cited, courts have held that surety, Section 533 does not apply to surety arrangements because it doesn't relieve the wrongdoer of liability. We cited a number of cases in that context. I will mention the Continental. I said, well, those cases don't apply because they involve public works projects. There's nothing in the cases that indicates that the fact that they involve public works projects or a statute that requires public works projects to have surety coverage had anything to do with the decisions. The discussion of surety coverage is quite generic. Now,
so what is the state? What's the status of the receivership now?
The receivership is continuing, and assets are being collected, and to the extent that Continental is obligated to pay what it promised to pay under its policies, those monies will be taken in by Mr. Dillon and distributed out to the exchangers.
And the receiver's distribution is subject to approval by the court?
I believe, I will double check before rebuttal. I believe that is the case, Your Honor. Now, Continental, I'm going to use just a few more seconds and then I'll save the remainder for rebuttal, but Continental makes the argument that because the policy in Condition 13 in Endorsement 1 says that this insurance is for your benefit only. It provides no rights or benefits to any other person or organization. This isn't a surety-type arrangement, and all of these principles that we've been talking about don't apply. What Continental fails to note is that Endorsement 3, which is what creates the surety arrangement, says expressly this endorsement changes the policy. So Condition 13, Endorsement 1 are changed, and Endorsement 3 does not contain
Section 533 of the California Insurance Code provides that an insurance company is not liable for loss allegedly sustained as a result of the willful acts of its insured. The district court in this case properly held that Section 533 precludes recovery for the loss that Mr. Dillon, as receiver for Vesta, is seeking to recover because that loss resulted from the intentional acts of Vesta's owners. On appeal, Mr. Dillon argues that the district court incorrectly found that the acts of the two individuals that owned Vesta, John Terzakis and Robert Estepinian, were imputed to Vesta. He also argues that the district court erred in finding that Section 533 applies even though third-party claimants may benefit from the proceeds of any recovery under an insurance policy.
Are you reading that section as saying that prohibits the payment of insurance proceeds to an injured person if the cause of the injury is willfulness?
Yes, Your Honor. I believe that's what the claimer...
You can't protect anybody against the willful act.
Section 533 and the public policy underlying it provide that an insurance company is not required to pay for a loss that results from intentional, willful, fraudulent conduct of the insured. So the purpose behind it is to prevent intentional torts.
He's not required to. What he's saying, they are prohibited from insuring and protecting a victim against any kind of willful conduct.
Well, I believe the way the courts have framed it is Section 533 is an exclusion that is read into every policy of insurance. So a policy of insurance does not provide coverage where the loss alleged results from the intentional conduct of the insured. It's an exclusionary provision that's read into every policy of insurance.
But it's an odd situation in the context of a fidelity bond, isn't it? Because that's exactly what you're trying to obtain insurance for. I mean, in every other context, if you're just talking about a general comprehensive liability policy or personal policy, you're talking about an occurrence, and usually intentional acts are excluded, but in this context, that's exactly what you're trying to buy insurance for, isn't it?
Well, the policy provides coverage for loss resulting from employee theft. So if the policy provides coverage, the loss would result from employee theft. That does not mean in this instance that the policy provides coverage, because in this instance, the loss resulted from the intentional criminal conduct of the two individuals that owned 100% of Vesta.
So the only way this would cover anything is if there were one owner or employee who was not a bad actor. Is that right?
Well, that would be an instance where it could provide coverage. And I think that example is an example that we use to explain how endorsement number 3 can be read to provide coverage for a situation where an owner is involved in the theft.
So basically what you're saying, in the case of a closed corporation or wholly owned corporation where the malfeasor is one of the owners, that it's an illusory policy.
There's no coverage.
Seriously, is the policy completely illusory in California for closed corporations?
No, it's not, Your Honor. And
why?
Let me explain why. If we look at endorsement number 3 to the policy, and I'm referring to the policy in the record that begins with numbers 2382 and goes on to number 2397.
Okay, what page are you on?
Endorsement number 3.
It's on page.
Is on page 2393.
Okay.
That endorsement provides... It's a title. It's not entitled surety endorsement. It's an endorsement that says includes owners and partners for losses involving client property. So what the endorsement does, it doesn't change every provision in the policy contrary to what counsel just said. it changes the policy as reflected in the endorsement. So first, provision number one, general exclusion A1. It's an exclusion in the policy form that excluded coverage for any loss committed by you or your partners. So without this endorsement, if any partner was involved in the theft, the exclusion would apply. This endorsement removes that exclusion where there are losses involving funds of client exchangers while the insured is acting as a qualified intermediary in a tax-deferred exchange under Section 1031.
Okay, so you think that this endorsement is not affected by the statute?
It depends on the facts of the claim, Your Honor. And I think, if I may go on and explain how the endorsement can be read so that it's not illusory. Provision number two provides, in addition to any other rights we have under the law or the policy, it is understood and agreed that any loss paid, as well as any fees, costs, or expenses incurred by us as a result of this extension of coverage, will be subject to the rights of recovery that we, as surety in this undertaking of employee dishonesty coverage, may have against you or your partners. This is a first-party property policy. It's a policy that insures Vesta, and it's issued by Continental. So the beneficiary of this policy is the insured Vesta. It's not a surety contract. A surety contract is a principal and obligee and a surety. So the difference here between a surety contract and the policy is that there is no underlying contract that is guaranteed. The risk is transferred here from the insured to Continental. Continental pays if there's a fortuitous event that results in a loss. What the trustee is arguing here, and what doesn't make sense in connection with the rest of the policy, is that this provision somehow makes the third-party claimants obligees or beneficiaries as they would be in a surety arrangement, and that is not consistent with the policy language. What this would do is, in the event that Vesta were owned by Trezakis Vesta Pinion, and just one of the two owners was a thief, one of the two owners was involved in the theft, the other is innocent. If a loss results of a client exchange funds, the innocent owner could get recovery, because Continental would guarantee or back the dishonest owner. Continental would pay the monies that were lost as a result of the dishonest owner,
right,
and seek to recover from that dishonest owner.
Right, but getting back to my original question, let's assume it's owned by one individual. That coverage would be illusory, wouldn't it?
If you could never
insure, they might pay premiums, but in fact there would never be a recovery under the policy if you had a single corporation owned by a single person who committed malfeasance. True.
If there was a single individual that committed the malfeasance and they were the alter ego of the company, the California law would preclude recovery.
So
for that individual.
In that instance, there would be, no matter how you sold the policy, it would be illusory. Because there would be no possibility of recovery for what you bargained for.
If there was an individual. That's not the case here.
No, I understand.
That's not the case here. Whether underwriting requirements would ferret those kind of situations out is another question.
Right. I understand the difference. I was trying to understand your argument. Now, if you take, let's assume for the second, for the sake of argument, that we accept Mr. Dillon's argument, do you think you have a right to subrogation if, in fact, a CNA is required to pay?
I believe we would have, if the court adopts his argument,
yes.
Then in the record below and in our briefs on appeal, we addressed why there are numerous other reasons that the policy would not provide coverage. The district court focused on what I believe is the most obvious reason, which is that Section 533 applies. There are many reasons why.
Right. I'm just trying to get a mechanical answer. I'm not taking you through your arguments. The question is, if we disagreed with the district court and if we disagreed on your coverage arguments and the money were awarded to the receiver, would CNA, in your judgment, have the right of subrogation?
Well, the policy certainly gives CNA the right to pursue recovery against you, the owner. Whether or not they would raise questions as to whether we are allowed to exercise that right is as an insurance company is another question, but I believe the policy does provide that right.
Well, if I'm reading the receiver's report correctly, this is what's occurred with other insurance companies, that they've asserted a right of subrogation and it's been accepted by the receiver, right?
I'm not sure that insurance companies have asserted rights of subrogation, Your Honor. I believe some insurance companies have settled and they have paid money to the receiver. But I'm not sure that the insurance companies have pursued Trezakis and Estepinian in this case.
I was looking, I think, I'm probably mispronouncing it, the Aiken insurance situation where subrogation is actually mentioned in the receiver's report.
Oh, in the Oaken? In another proceeding, Your Honor?
No, it's in the record in this case.
It's a different 1031 exchange entity.
That I don't know. I believe that was certainly not a bond case. It was, I believe, a legal malpractice insurance claim that was paid in, but the insurer was still asserting a right of subrogation that was being resolved within the context of the receivership.
And I believe in the legal malpractice context, the insurer would not have issued a fidelity bond.
No,
the insurer would have issued a different kind of policy.
My question is one of mechanics, that if you were, I mean, the way I understand this from looking at the entire picture is that if the receiver prevails on his claim against your company, the money would go in and you would still have a right of subrogation that would be resolved within the context of the receivership. Is that the way you would anticipate that mechanically working? I know you disagree that there's coverage at all, but I'm just trying to understand mechanically how this works in the context of the receivership.
That is the way Mr. Dillon has suggested it should work. The policy itself is a first-party policy where Continental pays to the insured Vesta. Mr. Dillon, as receiver, stands in the shoes of the insured Vesta. He doesn't represent the third-party claimants. He represents Vesta, so we would pay to him those monies, and he would distribute those in whatever way the court orders him to distribute those monies. We would have any rights of recovery against you as set forth in paragraph 2 of endorsement number 3. We take issue with the argument that Trezakis and Estepinian don't receive any benefit by receiving recovery under the policy because there are restitutionary orders that have been issued, and they are currently on the hook for the amounts that are still remaining that the exchangers have allegedly lost and haven't been repaid. So those liabilities would be reduced, and then we have a potential subrogation claim perhaps to execute, but I don't think that's the same thing. They do get a benefit by having that reduced.
So if it came down to subrogation for your company, do you think that it would have to be done within the context of the receivership, or would you maintain an independent subrogation claim?
I would assume we could do it in the context of the receivership because that's what we're paying. But having the receiver collect under a situation where you have two individuals who clearly committed a wrongful act, criminal act that resulted in the loss, what we would be doing is paying the money and going directly back to get the same money.
Right.
And that doesn't seem to make sense. What the policy as a whole reads is that the monies that were included as covered property per endorsement number 1 of the policy, if there was ever a point at which the third-party exchangers would have been identified as beneficiaries under the policy, it would have been there. Instead, endorsement number 1 specifically says they are not beneficiaries under the policy. The policy is for your benefit only. And when that provision is read in conjunction with endorsement number 3, the surety language, the surety arrangement that's being talked about can only be an arrangement that includes the insureds, you, the owners. And in a situation where you have several owners, one of which is the thief, and innocent owners, the surety arrangement applies so that Continental would pay Vesta, exercise a right of recovery against the wrongful thieving owner, but the obligees in the surety context would be the non-thieving owners. They're the beneficiaries under the policy. It's a two-party policy. And there simply is no California law that says that the alter ego of a corporation can recover insurance proceeds for the willful and intentional acts of its insured. The only time Section 533 would apply is if this is a surety arrangement. It's not a surety arrangement. It is a contract of insurance that acts as a surety in some respects and only acts as a surety with respect to a situation where there are owners that are both thieving owners and innocent owners.
Any further questions?
asbestos theft would be covered under Endorsement 3. Endorsement 3 says thefts by you or your partners or your owners, so that doesn't make any difference. Ms. Bauer said that under California law you can't protect anyone against a willful act. Well, if that would be the case, all surety coverage would be wiped out in the state of California, because that's what surety coverage, as I believe the court has suggested, that's what surety coverage does. It protects against the wrongful, willful, even criminal act of the primary obligor. The surety steps in, and then the obligee receives payment from the insurance company, and the insurance company is subrogated and goes after the wrongdoers. The point about there has to be an innocent owner, which I think is Continental's position, and the court has focused in response on, well, if there's only one owner, is the coverage illusory? I think that that's a very appropriate observation. But where is the language in Endorsement 3 that says that there has to be an innocent owner? Here, Continental marketed this to QIs that had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 members. The likelihood is that you could have a one-member QI, you could have a two-member QI, where both of them are involved in the scheme. It doesn't make any difference, because the point here is that when Continental pays the money to Mr. Dillon, it doesn't go into the general estate to benefit Vesta or to benefit the wrongdoers where they can pull it out. It goes into trust for Mr. Dillon to hold to pay the exchangers. The exchangers are indeed beneficiaries under Endorsement 3. As I pointed out earlier, the Condition 13 says there's no third-party beneficiaries. Endorsement 1 says there's no third-party beneficiaries. The reason is Endorsement 1 is changing the definition of covered property to include both things that are covered under the fiduciary part of the policy as originally written, and then to add exchanger property. So it has that generic language that says third parties aren't benefited. But when you get to Endorsement 3, that language is not there. The reason the language is not there is because the only way this can work is if the third parties are the beneficiaries. If the money goes into Vesta when Vesta steals the money, or to the owners where all of the owners are involved in stealing the money, the owners get the money back. And then, again, it makes no sense to say that Continental is then subrogated to rights of recovery, because it's going to go and pull the money back. The only way this makes sense is if Continental pays the money to the obligees, because this is a surety arrangement, has all the indicia of a surety arrangement, and Continental can then go against the wrongdoers or against Vesta, the estate of Vesta, to recover the money back if it believes that the wrongdoer's conduct should be imputed to Vesta. In the Oaken case that Judge Thomas, you asked about, there is a subrogation claim. That's a separate proceeding, another 1031 case that both Mr. Brace and I were involved in, and actually I believe Continental was one of the insurers in that case.
Yes, I'm just referring to that as an example where I was trying to understand the mechanics of how subrogation claims are handled within the context of the receivership.
Right, and that's what I tried to indicate to the court. So the way it works here is Continental honors its coverage obligations and pays the money to Mr. Dillon, who holds it in trust for the exchangers, just as Vesta was obligated to hold the money in trust for the exchangers. This was not money that went into the general corporate treasury that Vesta was entitled to use to finance its operations. It was held in trust. Mr. Dillon will do the same. The money will go to the exchangers, who in many cases lost their life savings as a result of the wrongdoers' actions. And then Continental can do what insurers do every day of the exact same claim as they would have faced had Continental not made this payment. And this is precisely what a surety arrangement is intended to do.
You're over your time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Honor.
The case just heard will be submitted for decision. Thank you both for your arguments.
Thank you.